Okay, I'm going to go ahead and start because we only got like 2 minutes left and let's get going. So, this is awkward. I wanted to stand up, but they only have these ones that sit on the table. So, my name is Eric Matos, and this is my friend Brian Pruitt. And this is my panel, Make Your Cosplay Look Like Crap. Now, probably half of you were here because you knew exactly what this was, and half of you were here because you were like, what the heck does that even mean?
And half of you here because you like feces.
No. It's on. Alright, this mic is off. sorry about that. Anyways, so I thought it was a cool title, but apparently I've heard people online that are just like, oh, I didn't get that. And I was like, oh, well. Basically, this is a panel about weathering. So, as you can see here, we have a few things that I've made for our Fallout Mario cosplay group that we do. And I'm just gonna talk to you guys about how I did that. Mostly a little bit about weathering, you know, cloth and stuff like that, but it's mostly stuff like weathering EVA foam. So, Brian and I want to run a YouTube channel called Strictly Nerd, where we post all kinds of nerdy things. But one of the things that I do on that channel is a show called Fabricate. And on that show, I show you guys pretty much what I'm going to be showing you now. So if you guys ever need to, this actual panel is going to be posted on our YouTube channel. So you can follow us on Facebook or YouTube, as you can see there. Strictly Nerds, pretty much, if you look that up, you're going to find us. And like, that's me. Yeah. I'm also an artist, so I drew that. That's me. I'm adorable. So, who am I? Well, my name is Eric Matos, and I've been making cosplay for about 7 years. This, actually, if any of you were here back in 2009, I wore this to San Japan. It was my first cosplay that I ever did, and it was at San Japan. So, I thought that was kind of cool. That costume was so uncomfortable. It was made out of cardboard, hot glue, and duct tape. And something that I learned that day is be very careful with making costumes with hot glue if you're going to a convention in Texas. Because as you can see on my arms, I used to have smokestacks, but they melted off from walking outside. So, and then I've also done a few other things. This is actually what I'm wearing tomorrow. It's an Azkaban prisoner costume. That costume I posted just before this one, and then our Fallout Mario costumes have actually been gone around the internet, so I found it on random sites, which is, it's really cool to find that, so hopefully you guys would think that I understand enough to show you guys what I do. That's a 3D printed Samaritan from Hellboy, and then those are a bunch of the props that I've done. I've actually been published on a UK magazine called Game Masters Magazine. I thought that was pretty cool, even though I couldn't buy the magazine because it was in the UK, so I had a friend of mine send it to me. It was from the Pip-Boy that I made. And then also, this may seem simple and not that cool to you guys, but I thought it was pretty awesome that tested.com retweeted my Power Fist, which I was gonna bring, but I left it in my car, and like I just said about leaving your cosplay, it melted pretty much. And then Adam Savage from the Mythbusters, who is my hero, retweeted my Power Fist. So I figured if I was good enough to be able to impress him, I could teach a few people what I know. I'm gonna drink some water. I won't tell you guys that every time I do it. So what we're gonna cover, first I'm gonna talk about distressing and weathering fabric. Then we're gonna talk about physically weathering EVA foam, and then paint weathering EVA foam. So one of the things that I like to say, and I honestly don't know if this quote, I don't know who said this quote, if anybody said it, but I thought of it one time, and I'm sure somebody else has said it before. It's that a knight in shining armor is a knight who's never seen battle. So a lot of things that I don't see a lot of weathering, I don't see enough weathering on cosplay, I think. You don't necessarily have to weather your cosplay. A lot of times you're trying to make your characters look really pristine and nice and like a cartoon character, an anime character, or something like that. They don't really have weathering on it, but I think when you're translating into the real world, weathering your cosplay really adds an extra element to it. Most of the comments and compliments that we get on our costumes is that there's a lot of detail, and that's really just, you know, the weathering techniques that I've used to make it look like we've done something. So how do you know if you should weather your cosplay? Well, is the source material weathered? That's a simple one. So if you're trying to make it look like something, you want to
look at that, and if it's weathered, then yeah, you should weather it. Does a character fight or engage in battle? Even if the source material isn't weathered, you can think about that kind of thing. I put a lot of thought into the costumes that I create because I feel like the more thought you put into the backstory of the character, like I have backstories for Peach, Luigi, and myself for these characters. You guys probably don't know the backstory. I'm not going to explain it to you because it's really long, but I wrote it just, at least not for me, so that I would be able to put more detail into my costume. So, is your character a badass? Well, he is a badass, then probably looks like he's weathered. And do you want your character to look like a badass? And then is it a real life version of the character? Something that I also notice is when people make real life versions of characters, and some people who don't recognize what exactly we're doing will say, oh, it's real life Mario, Luigi, and Peach. So, you know, it just, if you're bringing it into the real world, you want to tone down the colors some and that kind of thing. So I'm gonna go over a few tools that I use real quick. This is just gonna be a quick explanation before I actually get into the process of what I do to make my cosplay look the way that it does. So first I have craft foam. A lot of cosplayers know what craft foam is. It's a very thin foam that you can shape it with heat and by using a heat gun or something like that. It's used for very light armor. Sculpey is a polymer clay, and it's heated up in the oven. You can use it to do small details and stuff. I wouldn't recommend doing a lot with it because it could crack and everything. And then foam core board, the base and all this back here of my fat man here. I've heard a lot of people say, hey, look, a fat man. And I'm like, hey, that's not nice. But they're talking about this, it's from Fallout 4. But yeah, the whole base of this has been made out of craft foam, or not craft foam, I'm sorry, foam core board. And foam core board is really awesome in the sense that you can sand it. Like, all the edges and everything, you can sand it down, and it sands really smooth and clean. So, I like to use it for building a base of something, and then I did like craft foam for the sides and everything, mainly because you can't really bend foam core very well. And then, of course, EVA foam. Now, you can see it there, you might recognize that from like gyms, and not the restaurant, the place where you work out, something I don't really know much about. Like little kids' playrooms and stuff like that. They use them for the floor, and somebody decided, hey, I'm gonna make armor out of that, and thank God for that person. X-Acto knife, paintbrush, ruler, scissors, those are all useful. Hot glue gun, I put everything together with hot glue. I use high temp hot glue, mainly because we live in Texas, and even then, it doesn't really keep it from melting in the heat, but it melts at a higher temperature, therefore it'll take a higher temperature to remelt it when you're wearing it on your costume. So I recommend high temp hot glue for people who live in Texas. And also be very careful because that stuff burns. I have a lot of scars from it. Sharpies, Dremels are really, it's just a rotary tool. Dremel is the brand. I use it to sand out detail and stuff like that. It's a fast way to sand rather than by sanding with your hands. A heat knife. This one's actually just an X-Acto knife. You plug into the wall, it gets hot. On EVA foam, EVA melts. So it gets a really nice clean cut when you're trying to make sure that you want it to, you know, a lot of my stuff, it doesn't really matter whether or not it looks clean because I'm gonna make it look like crap anyways. But it's helpful. The main thing that you wanna do when cutting EVA foam is use very, very sharp blades. So if you're working on a certain section of armor or something like that, once you're done with that section, switch out the blade for a new one or sharpen your blades and it gives you really nice cuts. That's fabric dye, cloth dye. I use that for, well, dyeing cloth obviously, but also for doing weathering. Use like a brown or a black or something like that, put it in a spray bottle and spray it on there. You can also use airbrushes obviously, but you know, not everybody has the money for airbrushes. Acrylic paint is what I do, pretty much all the detailing stuff, spray paint and acrylic paint. Mod Podge, what do I say Mod Podge? Mod Podge, it's actually a adhesive, but it is also a sealant. And it goes on white, but it dries clear. So you wanna, I use Mod Podge all the time. It's the best thing for a sealant for anything. So I always recommend it, and I'll show you guys a little bit more about that later. E6000 is just a really good adhesive. It takes a while to dry, but it's a very strong bond. Metallic, that is actually metallic wax is what it's called. The name brand is called Rub and Buff. And I use that to do, I used to use spray paint to do the, you know, make it look like there's scratches and stuff on metal, but I've started using that just recently, and it works out really well. The fine grain sand, I mix it into paint so that I can make the rust have texture and stuff, but I'll show you a little bit more about that later. Fuller's Earth, that stuff I just discovered, and it's really cool. It is basically dirt, but it is clean dirt. So they sell it to you, and it's just totally, this stuff is, it's really awesome because I put it on pretty much everything that I have, mostly for cloth, because it makes it look like your, well, your cloth is dirty, obviously. So, but it's clean, so you can put it on there and then kind of wipe it off a bit. Like I said, I'll talk about that in a minute. Texas Dirt, that actually is used, I use that on my costume as well, but it's like makeup pretty much, so you can make it look like you're putting dirt on your face. Paper disposable plates are really good for mixing paint, sandpaper, paper towels, soldering iron. That's actually a really important thing that I use. All of the detail, all of this, you know, messiness and that you see on here has been done with soldering iron. I don't use it to actually solder things because it probably wouldn't be very good because I, you know, burned all this stuff onto it, but that's the main thing that I use. Sponge, paints, spray paints, those are carving tools for the Sculpey, and then a cup. So, gonna get into the actual meat. Weathering cloth. So, the picture on the left is actually not a, technically a before picture because it's already been weathered, but that's before I put Fuller's Earth on it. So, on the left, you can see that it doesn't, you know, look as dirty as it does on the right, but on the right, I put Fuller's Earth on it. I cleaned a lot of it off, and that's what stuck to it. So when you're weathering cloth, I actually use cheese graters. The one on the left, the finer one, I tend to use that one a lot, mainly on really heavy fabrics like denim. You want to use it on the heavy fabrics because if you use it on a lighter fabric, it's more likely to just tear it a lot more. So they work really well to use on the seams. I used it on all over this costume and, you know, his overalls and everything, and it just frays it. It'll make holes in it if you do it long enough, so it's really handy. And then also sandpaper. The, I don't know honestly if it's higher grade or lower grade, but the one that has bigger chunks of sand on it, that's what I use on pretty much everything else. And like I said, it does the same thing. It'll rip, it'll tear. If you're doing something like a pant leg or your sleeve, the end of your sleeve or something like that, take a pair of scissors, you cut up into it and then at, you know, various angles, and then you take some sandpaper and then you just like go to town on that. Just lay it on a flat surface and mess it up really bad, and it frays all of the fat, the fibers and everything, and it makes it look like it's, it hasn't been done on purpose. Because the main thing about weathering is you don't want it to look like you did it on purpose, you want it to look like time and use has done it. So, concrete and dirt, this is kind of if you don't have money for the other Fuller's Earth, or which isn't really expensive, you can get it on Amazon, or sandpaper. When using these two, I don't really recommend using these, but you can if you need to, because just rubbing something, you know, the cloth on the on concrete does the same thing. And dirt, just make sure that you're using a fairly clean area, not an area with pets. Which that area that I took a picture of definitely has pets. But there's no pet mess there. Paint, acrylic paints, I find that acrylic paints work really well. You definitely don't want to use, I mean, these are water soluble, but like I said, when you, you're going to seal pretty much everything with Mod Podge. So once you do that, it's not going to come off unless you try to scrape it off. And I will dry brush, which, if you don't know what dry brushing is, it's where you dip your brush into the paint and then you get most of the paint off of it. Use a napkin or something like that, get it to the point where it's not a lot left on it, and then you brush it on there because it doesn't look as thick and it doesn't look as apparent. And then like on my shirt, I did it around, you know, the areas that you think would get worn, like around the neck and stuff like that, obviously armpits, places that get a lot of sweat and dirt. And then Fuller's Earth. So Fuller's Earth is my favorite thing, like I said. The Fuller's Earth that I have, it has the color and consistency of flour. And that brings me to my first pro tip. Don't use it in place of flour. It makes really bad cakes, trust me. But my also real pro tip is use safety glasses, mask, and do it outside. Because it's not 18 plus, Brian, stop it. Because basically that stuff will go everywhere. It is a very, very, very fine powder, so it will, and this comes from experience, it will cover everything in your living room in a fine dust. So Fuller's Earth, they actually use in films. Whenever you see, you know, dust coming off of a character when they make their costumes look really dirty, if you see, you know, a wizard pick up an ancient tome and blow off the dust, that is usually Fuller's Earth, because it's clean dirt that they can put on anything. So the way that I applied it on this costume is, I have a tarp, and if you don't have a tarp and you do this kind of stuff, get a tarp, because they're awesome. You can lay them out anywhere, spray paint on them, do all this kind of stuff on them, and then pick them up and put them away. So it's just a reusable surface. We live in a townhouse that we're renting, so I don't want to get spray paint on this on the back porch, so I use this tarp. So I'll take the Fuller's Earth into my hands, sprinkle it onto the garment, and like you can see here, I just sprinkled it all over. It doesn't have to be uniform or anything. It's better that it's not uniform, actually. And then I, as odd that it may sound, I go barefoot and I stomp it. So it helps to get it into it. It also kicks up clouds that can settle in different areas and stuff like that. And it really works it into the fabric. And then once I do that, this is just his shirt that I've done it on. Once I do that, beautiful. I pick up the piece of fabric or whatever I'm working on and actually just like smack it, because as you can see here, you can see those areas where the Fuller's Earth hit and it just has these little dots and stuff like that. It doesn't matter, you know, how much you shake it off and stuff, you'll be able to see those unless you actually pretty much beat the fabric. It's just like you're taking a carpet outside and beating the dirt off of it and stuff like that. You're beating most of it off, but it still makes it look really weathered and awesome. Like I said earlier, you can also use dye, different shades of dye, and you can use it like you would an airbrush. Put it in a bottle, spray it onto different areas, and it adds some variety to the color of whatever garment you're working with. Now we get into the fun stuff, weathering props. This is the physical weathering stuff. You can see this is my shoulder pad that I'm wearing right now. To the left, it is before, after I just built it and I didn't do any weathering to it. And to the right is after I was done weathering. This was done with the soldering iron. So you can see here, the soldering iron it's really cool. You can get them fairly cheap, and it just melts your armor and everything so that it looks all messed up. It's very good. Don't burn yourself because it hurts. However, I always say that you're not really working on cosplay unless you burn yourself, because it happens every single time. Even if you're not working with something hot. You mess up and then you make a joke and you go, ooh, burn on me. Okay, so I've got these gifts, thanks to gifts.com. I couldn't get rid of that watermark, I'm sorry. I'm not repping them or anything. Anyway, so basically what these gifts are gonna show you is the process that I use to weather a, it looks like it essentially looks like a chunk of metal. And it was just so that I could show you guys different techniques and everything that I do to make something look metal, because that's what I like to do the most, is make things look like metal and rusted metal. So here I'm taking the soldering iron. This is sped up, I don't actually work that fast. I'm taking the soldering iron and going around the edge and doing very random, kind of just burning it in just random spots. And when I'm doing this, I'm actually thinking of rust. Something that I really recommend is that if you guys ever see rust or on anything, take a picture of it, because I have, like, my phone is full of pictures of rust, and it's kind of weird, but it really helps you, like, so that you can actually see how rust works, because rust sometimes will cover an area, sometimes it'll actually start eating through, and so this is what I was thinking, you know, the rust is eating through the metal on the outside. And then I start to do other details. That's like a bullet hole, or just burned it and then started, you know, working my way out so that it was a little bit more shallow and shallow, and then I do a lot of random details. I mean, that's just putting a big scratch in it. At the very end, I will just kind of go over it, you know, in my hand, and just kind of do random stuff, let it hit where it wants, because I want it to look, you know, fairly random. There's certain areas that I want to look a certain way, but for the most part, I want it to look random, and in the end, it looks like that. So the other thing about melting EVA foam is it actually works as a sealant itself, because when you melt the EVA foam, it makes it so that it's not porous, and the reason that you have to seal EVA foam, which you need to do that every single time you paint EVA foam, you need to seal it with Mod Podge first, because otherwise the paint is going to soak into it, and you can tell that it'll look like foam. Another thing you can use is a heat knife for doing pretty much what I just did, but those are going to be a lot, you know, sharper. It's going to have a lot sharper look to it. And then sandpaper. EVA foam sands fairly well. So whenever you're sanding EVA foam, you cut it to whatever shape you want. You can sand down the edges so that they're rounded and stuff. And then you'll notice that when you sand it, it'll have these tiny little pieces of foam sticking up, little like foam hairs almost. If you have a heat gun or a blow dryer, blow dryers don't work as well. You can hit it with that and it'll actually melt those off so that they disappear. And it works really well to smooth out your EVA foam. So this is the painting portion of it. This is my fat man here, on the left and the right. Pretty much just painted and unpainted. I did a base coat on the whole thing with some spray paint. It was just a primer spray paint. Excuse me. And then I went in and actually painted it with spray paint, and then did all kinds of other stuff with acrylic paints and stuff, which I'm gonna talk about now. So the base coat and Mod Podge, when I base coated it, even though it was already gray, I still put a coat of gray onto it. But before I did that, I had to coat it in Mod Podge. If you have a heat gun or a blow dryer, you can actually speed up the process of drying Mod Podge with that. It dries really fast, even on its own, but it'll dry a lot faster with that. You can also use it for paint. So it was Mod Podge, and then I did a base coat of gray. If you're actually wanting this kind of dull metal look to come through, you're gonna wanna do a base coat of gray, but with different shades of gray in there, so it actually looks like metal. It has a different, you know, hues and variety to it. And then I Mod Podge it again. You can see here that you can see all the little white pieces and stuff like that. It wasn't dry yet, and I got impatient, so. Then I did black washing. You might hear black washing, you might hear white washing, or brown washing, it doesn't matter. A wash is basically the same thing, but I do a lot of black wash. Black wash is once you've gotten your base coat and your Mod Podge is dry, you take black acrylic paint and then you mix it with some water. And that makes it so that it's a lot easier to wipe off, which is very important because you're gonna have to do that. You cover the entire thing. If you're working on a big piece, you might wanna work in sections, but you're still going to want to make it so that you don't stop in a section that's going to be noticeable. You cover the entire thing in the black water paint mixture, and then you're going to immediately, before it dries, you're going to wipe it off. And as you can see, I'm just wiping it off with a paper towel, and what it does is it gets into all of that detail that you did with the soldering iron. It's going to get into the crevices, all the scratches, and it's going to make it look a lot more apparent. So you can actually tell, you know, the weathering. Because if you're using, you know, your armor and stuff as a character in battles or travels or whatever, there's dirt gonna get on it and it's gonna get into the crevices and everything. So you're mimicking that with this black wash. You can also do a brown wash over it as well, which I didn't do here. But you can see that's the final result of it. Just an example of how important and awesome black washing is. The one on the left is not blackwashed, the one on the right is blackwashed, and that's all I did to it, was blackwash it. So these cheap little Halloween things that I got from my sister-in-law's wedding, who got married in Halloween and ruined Halloween for all the kids that had to go. Don't get married on Halloween, people. But anyways, and then she gave these to me, and so we were working on some props for our Harry Potter themed wall in our room. And I wanted to use these, and that's all I did, was cover it in black, wipe it off, and it looks insanely different. It looks like that one I paid 2 cents for, and the other one I paid like $5 for. So it's still cheap, but still. Definitely use black wash whenever you want to make something look weathered. So after that, I started doing the scratches, and this is where the metallic wax comes in. I'm using a sponge, and then even though this isn't the name brand, which is Rub and Buff, I'm using the off-brand stuff because it actually comes, the rubber buff comes in these tubes, these little squeeze tubes, and this stuff comes in a larger mouthed container, so it's easier to just dip it in there. And I'm pretty much just going in all around the areas that would be worn by contact or something like that. Now, this is just a chunk of metal, so there's not really a lot of logic behind that, because it's, you know, you don't go running around with a chunk of metal all the time. But I was just trying to show what it would look like. So it's pretty much the whole surface has been, you know, exposed to something that would brush away all the grime and everything and just like have this polished metal underneath. And then in the end, it looks like that. So the main thing that I get questions about whenever people see our costumes is how I do rust. And so I'm going to show you guys the rust process, because rust can look really, really cool and it can also not come out that great. So the way I do rust is I get a brown acrylic, and the kind of acrylic, the color is called bark brown, I believe. So I do brown acrylic and actually mix some of that fine sand that I showed you guys before into it to give it a texture. Because if you ever see actual rust, a lot of times it has a very sandy texture to it, which I'm going to add to that later. But just to start, because I want to add some variety, I just put this really fine sand into it for the base layer of it. And then I go around to all the areas that I think would be rusted, which in this piece of metal, pretty much it's just the outside is being eaten away by the rust towards the middle. So after that, I use a mix orange and brown paint, which is, it's like a burnt orange. And there's different colors of rust. There's the yellowish rust, there's a reddish rust, and then there's orange. I like the orange rust better just because it looks cool and it's my favorite color. So I go in and kind of stipple and dry brush this orange rust over it. And then as you can see there, I'm going over the metallic part because, you know, even the rust is eating away at certain areas, it starts to spread over the surface. And then next, I will actually go over it with orange. It's like straight up orange. And then stippling that on there, and then I have that. So that's the final product. That's what it looks like at the very end. Or for the most part, it looks like a big chunk of rusted metal. And it's the stuff that's awesome about this is it's extremely light. I've seen people with props and everything. This is actually, it's fairly light, but it still hurts to hold all day. But yeah, you can make awesome armor that looks like it's a big chunk of metal and it's extremely light. And then I'll go over it with Fuller's Earth sometimes, as you can see here. And I just kind of brush it into the to all of the little crevices and everything with a brush. And then that's it. So in the end, that's what it looks like. I think it looks pretty cool. I don't know about you guys. But that's it. And like I said, all of these gifts that are on here are from a video that I made for our YouTube channel, so you can watch the entire process on there. And then, of course, this panel is going to be on our YouTube channel as well. What's the time?
How is our panel?
30, or an hour,
right?
Yep. I still have a lot of time.
Okay, well, anyways, at this point, I will answer any questions if you guys have any questions. I can also, first of all, let me, hold on a sec. There's another method that I actually don't have on here, but I thought was really cool. So if you take a prop, you can paint it whatever base metal color that you want, and then after you're done with that, you take liquid latex and you paint certain areas of it. So you can just, whatever you want to look rusted and or flaked away, and then you paint another coat on top of it of a certain color, say blue. So once that top coat dries, you can actually peel away the liquid latex and it'll look like the paint is chipped. That's something that I wish I had known that already, but it works really, really well. You could just, you know, make it look like your paint is chipped away and stuff instead of having to try to fake it on a top layer. So it's a really simple trick, but I thought I'd share that with you guys. Yeah. Anybody got any questions? No? Anything? I can also answer questions about particular cosplays if you guys had any questions about trying to make something.
Well, I was just going to ask you about weathering the painted metal, but you just answered that question before I asked it, so.
Yes. I used to do it whereas I would paint it and then I would go with that rub and buff stuff and I'll go around it, you know, and make it look like it's chipped that way. But yeah, if you use a liquid latex, it peels off that top layer that you just put on, and it reveals the metal underneath.
Yeah, that first one you mentioned with the rubbing buff on the edges, that was the one that I had heard of before, and then you mentioned the liquid latex, and then I'm like, yeah.
I'm glad you took something away from it then. yeah, what's up, Nick? Yes. I mean, random person that I don't know.
What? Can you talk a little bit about those awesome little pieces you found around the house on the Game Boy?
The Pip-Boy?
Yes.
Sure, hand me the Pip-Boy.
The
Pip-Boy. So, sorry if you guys can't see very well in the back and everything, but this is a Pip-Boy that I made. This is the one that was featured in the magazine in the UK. And basically, I save a lot of stuff. Like, I will save the most random things. It's just small things that, you know, people think that you should throw away, and I don't do that. So, I feel bad for my wife, but, you know, she gave me a room to put all that stuff in, so that's good. So, as you can see on here, this is like, this little piece right here is a knob. It's like the top of a glue stick. So I took the lid of a glue stick and stuck it on there. Here, this is a pill bottle that the bottle of pills was not empty, so sorry to my wife about that too. And then as you can see back here, it's actually an entire pill bottle that I used for this. So I will use the most random things, and it's very good to be resourceful when you're making your cosplay because it's cheaper. Oh yeah, compared to this one is actually the one that you got with the special edition of Fallout 4. This is the one that he wears because I still haven't made him a custom one. Sorry, Brian. And he's a collector, so he has a bunch of really awesome collectibles, and he won't let me weather this. If this was mine, it would have been weathered the moment I took it out of the box. But yeah, you can see this is very clean and nice, and mine is very dirty. It's not perfect. I mean, my wife's actually looks better than this one. Because I made it second, so. But yeah, I used in-game pictures and everything as reference, and then I just found whatever I could find to make it, you know, look like knobs and different stuff like that. And then, you know, as you can probably see the guns, they are Nerf guns. And yeah, we actually, there are people who are taking pictures of this and who are such extreme Fallout fans that they're like, those are Nerf guns, those aren't in the universe.
But then you also get YouTube has a big community of Nerf mod folks, and they're like, oh my god, I can't believe you used the Vulcan 451
whatever
to mod into this, and we're like, sure.
Yeah, we did it on purpose. This one actually did pick on purpose because it looks a lot like the 10mm if you play Fallout at all. This one looks a lot like it. Somebody was like, oh, you made the 10mm, and I was like, no, it's not. It's actually a ripoff. But yeah, it looks enough like it that I was like, okay, cool, let's use that one. And then the other ones, we were just like, we need stuff to go on our belts and stuff like that, so. And then the Star Shield is EVA foam. Like I said, pretty much I make all of my stuff out of EVA foam. This right here, my Bullet Bill Mini Nuke, is actually a poster board. I rolled poster board for this piece. This is poster board, so it's extremely light. This is a piece of styrofoam that I bought at Hobby Lobby. It's already just a rounded piece, so I pretty much based the size of this thing off of this piece in the end. And then I just, you know, you can see the seam right here from where the poster board is. And it goes on the bottom, so you can't see it on the actual prop. But yeah, this one is super simple, and it took me maybe an hour to make, so. This sounds like bragging. And then that frying pan over there, we got it at a thrift store.
Yeah,
okay.
That's a bazooka. Actually, it's just paint buckets, 5 gallon buckets, and a mixing bowl.
So it's two paint buckets and a mixing bowl. That mixing bowl was still being used. I'm sorry to my wife about that. Pretty much nothing in our house is safe from me being like, I want that, I'm using it. I somehow paid for it, I'll do something else. And then the handle on there is from a Nerf gun that's actually, like, it's cool that you never use it, but it pops out.
It doesn't make any sense.
So what? Yay! Did you see that? They were amazed.
They were. I stand corrected.
Yeah, so I just pretty much bolted two buckets together for that, and that, a lot of people think it is pretty cool. And then this one it's another thing that I didn't show you guys that I got retweeted was this by the Fallout page. They retweeted this. I thought that was cool too. I'm so cool.
Anyway, so is there any other questions? Go for it.
I don't know if this was covered, I got here a little late. Do you have any advice on how to make something look like rotted, weathered wood?
That I haven't really messed with, okay. But I do wands. I make Harry Potter wands, Harry Potter universe wands, so don't sue me.
Wizard tools.
Yeah, wizard sticks. I make wizard sticks. They're pretty. I'm gonna change that to wizard sticks on Etsy. no, I make them and sell them on Etsy. So if anybody's interested, it's called generic wands. And I'll explain that real quick. My wife's name is Jin and my name is Eric. So it's Jin Eric. Clever boy. Anyways, and so our tagline is wands that are anything but generic, but that's spelled the right way. I make them and sell them, and a lot of times once something that I realize that I need to do is make them look like they have wood grain to them. So that's like a matter of painting them brown and then painting the wood grain with a darker color or a lighter color in a very small paintbrush. So I can make stuff look like wood, but I actually haven't ever really tried to make it look like weathered wood. However, I will do that. And then next year at San Japan, I will have that in my presentation.
I would think that maybe even like the soldering iron to give it the...
I think the soldering iron is going to work.
You can give it the kind of sunken in edges, and then using paint would and paint different textures.
Yeah.
Using sand in the darker recesses of the burnt wood would...
I think that just came to my mind. It was like modeling flock moss, actually.
Yeah, that's true. I've worked with that before. I took a toy that was a little toy castle and I repainted it, blackwashed it, and then I put that moss all over the side. So yes, that would actually be really good. If they have it in, you know, the Hobby Lobby sections where the modeling trains are and all that kind of stuff. That would definitely work. Anybody else?
On the wands, before we escape the wands, we'll be here tomorrow on the floor as the Death Eater group.
Yeah.
And so if you want to see some of these wands or how things are looking, you can always track this down.
Because the way that I make the wands, you guys get a little bonus wand creation thing. The way that I make the wands is I actually take branches from trees in my backyard, and then I whittle them down to a shape so that it tapers to the end. And then I add detail on the handles with sculpting, which is what I showed you guys before. You wrap the handle wherever you're gonna put the handle, you wrap it in some thin wire, and then you start to sculpt the handle onto it. And then you can put the entire thing into the oven. At 275 for like 15 minutes for a wand, you can put the entire thing in the oven. It's not gonna do anything to the wood, and it'll harden the handle. And then once that cools off, you paint it. And that's how I make my wands. I'm not trying to, you know, keep it a secret so that more people will buy my stuff or anything. Like, you guys can totally go ahead and do it. That's why I'm here, to teach you how to do things that I know how to do. Does anybody else have any questions?
How much is EVA foam? Where do you get it?
EVA foam, I've found that you can buy a 4-pack of those big, you know, puzzle pieces that I showed you. You can buy a 4-pack of those for about $20.
It's like $20,
$25. Yeah, online you probably get it cheaper. But like one time at Ross, I found a 6-pack for $20. So that was just lucky. But you can get it for sure at Home Depot.
In the shop areas, like,
yeah, with tools and stuff like that.
Like the tools and like the workshop accessories and stuff are. It's meant to be floor, like non-slip flooring, in like tool sheds and stuff. So it's all going to be stacked about.
And they also have EVA foam that you can buy in rolls online. And the thing about those is you can actually buy double smooth EVA foam, which for a prop maker is amazing. Because the thing about all these costumes is, as you can see
underneath,
it has a weird texture, because that's supposed to, you can either use that side or the other side for grip. But the double smooth EVA foam looks smooth on both sides, so you can do whatever you want to on both sides and it'll look however you want. You don't have to worry about working around that texture on the bottom. So that's very helpful.
Do you have any techniques for hiding seams in props where you're joining the EVA foam?
On EVA foam, the best thing to do is you can take the, where you're gonna put the seams, like if you're taking a piece of EVA foam and you're folding it, you know, to make a circle, you glue it and then you can sand it. Yeah, so you know, it doesn't matter how dirty it looks or anything like that, you just sand it and then eventually it'll get to the point where you can't even see it anymore.
And I don't have it here, but I made a mask that was similar to that one. But it essentially was two pieces of EVA foam that I, you know, combined to a seam in the middle, and I totally sanded the seam away. And on top of that, once you start to add paint to it, the layers of paint is also going to help conceal it. Especially when you're using, like I said, Mod Podge. Mod Podge makes a very thin layer of what's essentially plastic. So when you put layer and layer of Mod Podge paint, Mod Podge and that kind of thing, it's going to get rid of it as well. So yeah, EVA foam is it sands extremely well. So it's super awesome. That's why it's such a versatile, you know, material that pretty much every cosplayer uses. Anything else? Yes.
Do y'all do any
commission work? I do take commission work, but it depends on what it is. I've had people ask me to, like, the other day I had a guy ask me to create him a Deadpool mask, and that's mostly sewing, you know? So it depends on what you want, but yes, I do take commission work, and we can talk about whatever it is that you want to create, and then I give you a price, because it's the amount of time and then also the materials that go into it. But pretty much like weapons and armor and stuff like that, if it's supposed to be solid like this, I could probably make it. I'm really boasting a lot.
But you missed the most important part of the Deadpool costume.
What?
What did he want on it, though?
He wanted Wolverine sideburns on the outside. I was like, okay. He just wanted, yeah, he wanted Wolverine sideburns glued to the outside of it, and I was like, dude, buy a freaking Deadpool mask and glue some sideburns to the outside of it. It's not like those are hard to find. Anybody else? Yes?
It's slightly unrelated, but how is that attached to your shoulder?
Pins. I've, like, glued some little pins to the bottom of it, and then I have my wife attach it to my shoulder whenever I put the costume on, which is extremely frustrating for her, so it really tests your relationship when getting ready for cosplay.
Yeah, that's the beauty of like foam, is it takes well, especially if you leave the textured bottoms, the hot glue will really seep into the textured bottom, and it kind of gives it a really good grip. So all you have to do is put pins on it, and then it pins to the shirt, mine's the same way.
Yeah, it's the same way it pins it. Most of the stuff that's attached to us is pinned that way.
Mine is the numbers. The numbers are actually the big numbers are sewn on, are they not?
Yes, yeah, the numbers on our back, which you really can't see on us. You can see it on Peach's jacket, but we have a number 64 back there, and those are sewn. It's the only sewing that we did. Yeah, she's in the back. Everybody look back there.
You're waving in the way.
There we go. Yeah. And she was the one that sewed those on there, so. Yeah. Like I said, I'm not very good sewing. Did you have another question?
How likely is the paint to crack after doing so many layers?
You can actually, on this stuff, it does crack. And I should have brought that thing that I showed you guys how I made. I should have brought that with me. You can take it, give me your mask.
Which one?
The Shy Guy mask.
Oh.
I'm gonna crack it.
Oh no!
Yeah, so this Shy Guy mask, I did it, you know, the way that I explained to you guys, it's layers of paint and stuff like that. And if you bend it, you can hear it cracking, but the thing is, when it goes back, it's totally gone. Like there's no way. So whatever shape you're gonna put it in, if you crack it at all, if you turn it and everything like that, it's gonna crack, but it won't show. And on top of that, when you're weathering something, it doesn't really matter because you know if something happens to you, you're like, oh, that just adds character to it. So the cracking paint isn't really that big of a deal. It actually reminded me. This mask reminded me of something. Oh yeah, you can see this little thing right here is a lid to it. Drink of some sort. But when you want to shape,
it's Gatorade.
Oh, it's a Gatorade. Why do you know so much about the lids to drinks? It's a weird thing. When you want to shape EVA foam, you use a heat gun or a blow dryer. Blow dryers do not work very well, but they do work. It just takes a long time for it to get hot enough. I would really highly recommend buying a heat gun if you're going to work with EVA foam because they're awesome. But basically, whatever piece you're going to want to shape, you lay it out flat. You're going to want to hit the side that you're not actually going to be painting, so the back of it, like the underside of it, and you're just going to take the heat gun over a few times until it's, you know, it gets really nice and warm, and then you mold it into the shape that you want it to be in,
hold it there while it cools off, and then when you let go, it won't it'll keep that shape. So another reason why UV foam is so awesome, it retains the shape.
Can you do that multiple times?
Or? Yes, yeah, you can do it over and over again, because a lot of times it'll actually start to, you know, it once you mold it to shape and stuff, it'll kind of start to bend back out. But if you do it a few times, it'll get to the point where it just bends out to the shape that you want to do, you want it to be in. Nick?
Did you use puff paint for the welding star?
No, that's actually hot glue. Yeah, I use hot glue for the welding, but puff paint works as well. Yeah, I've used puff paint on wands and stuff like that. When you want to add raised detail to anything, you can use puff paint. It's kind of difficult to get really clean lines with puff paint, though. But it's you know, the main thing that I like to think of is for when I'm working on the cosplay and stuff like that is pictures. How it's going to look in a picture. Because mostly these people are going to see it and they're going to admire it and stuff. And they're going to want to take a picture of it. And you want to make sure that it looks good for that. So there's little details on, you know, all of my props and everything that if you guys came up here and actually looked at it, you could probably see that, I don't know, he messed up there, you know, that doesn't look right. But in pictures, it looks great. So you have to remember that you're working for pictures. Another thing that I just realized, that if you look at the rust on here, that's actually, I went over with Mod Podge the areas that I wanted it to be rusty. Mod Podge, I'm sorry. I went over it with Mod Podge, and then, I keep on saying Mod Podge, I don't know why.
Everybody says it.
Yeah, they should change it. Yeah, they should change it to Mod Podge. That's right! Get out the pitchforks and torches, let's go. But anyway, so I covered it, and then I went with that really fine sand, and I went over those areas, and stuck to it, and then I painted it. And that was just to add texture. It looks pretty good. I don't know if I like it that much. I actually didn't use the soldering iron to do the weathering beforehand. If I would have done that and then did that step, I think it would have ended up looking really nice. But yeah, that's a good, it's an extra thing that you can do to add texture to something is gluing sand to it, pretty much. Anybody else?
What's your next new project? I mean, you guys are doing like movies or?
I've had people tell me that you know, our stuff looked like, the props look movie, you know, screen worthy and stuff, which would be amazing. But like I said, we're computer technicians for a school district, so that's kind of where we're at. Well, they do, man, the school has a lot of awesome stuff that I wish I could use. 3D printers that I actually can't use because I'm a 3D printer tech. But, no, I didn't. The thing about 3D printing is, and then this is mainly my opinion, 3D printing is really good for people who aren't very good at doing this kind of stuff. So if you find that you've tried and it doesn't really work very well, you can 3D print and it'll look really nice. And then it's all about the painting, you know, the paint job that you put on it. But other than that, I personally think that if I can make it this way, I'd rather do that because I feel more accomplished saying that I totally made this out of a piece of foam than, you know, I printed it on a printer. There's nothing wrong doing that. 3D printers are really getting cheaper and more accessible nowadays, and they print out some really awesome stuff.
Your Samaritan 3D printed, right? The picture of the Hellboy gun that
The Hellboy gun that I showed.
Was actually 3D printed, and then
it was 3D printed.
He had to do it in separate pieces, no?
Yep, and it took 32 hours to print.
and that's why 3D printing is a secondary option.
Yeah. That you I pretty much just printed it and walked away. I pressed print and walked away. One of the things that me and Brian are working on, at least, is Old Man Link and Ganon. And he wants to look like Link, but after he's been alive for years and years, gray and, you know, battle torn and stuff like that. And I'm doing a Ganon, but I'm doing Pig Ganon. Because I like to cosplay stuff that is, you know, reflects my body type.
Which is sexy.
So I like to cosplay my body type. There's nothing wrong with not cosplaying. You can cosplay whatever you want, but personally, I like to cosplay my body type. So I am going to be Pig Ganon, and it's going to look really cool. So I'm really excited about it because I'm making a mask that's, you know, looks like the boar face and stuff like that I'm working on, and I'm going to have these really awesome spiky shoulders and stuff. So that's going to be cool. It's going to take a while, but that's what we're working on. It's going to be a while. But then we'll probably run with Fallout Mario and Luigi. Like, we, before, if you had gone to PAX, not this past one, but the one before that, and then I think Alamo City, we were there as Steampunk Mario, Luigi, and Peach. And a lot of people come up to us and they're like, hey, Steampunk, and they're like, yeah, we're Fallout this time, but pretty much the same. I mean, we recycled a lot of the costumes to fit this. But yeah, so we've done that. We're doing this version of them. We're thinking about doing a medieval version of the Mario, Luigi, and Peach as well. Mainly her, because she really wants to be able to wear it to Ren Fair.
She wants to wear a dress that we don't destroy.
And it's gonna kill me. No, I gotta weather it a little bit. What's that noise? You can weather stuff by not washing it, but it gets stinky.
That's all about constant.
My Ren Fair costume actually hasn't been washed in a while. Because it looks so worn, there's like mud on the bottom of it and stuff, and I'm like, oh, it's so awesome. And Jen's like, you need to wash that. So we just keep it in a zipped container in a closet.
I know a part of your Ren Fair costume that got washed.
What?
Your flute.
Oh, my flute. I dropped my flute to a urinal trough.
No.
10 minutes after I bought it. It's this beautifully hand-carved wooden flute that Jen got me for my birthday. And I put it into my belt, and then I went to go to the bathroom, and it just and I was like, ugh. And then my brother was next to me, using the bathroom, laughing. And I was just like, so I picked it up with some paper towels and went and washed it off. And then Jen contacted the guy that made those, and she was like, how do you clean these? Because an accident happened. And so he was just like, so I used rubbing alcohol or something, and I cleaned it a whole bunch. And I play it. I still play the flute. I paid $35 for that thing. So I don't care. It's clean. But yeah, it was pretty embarrassing, but that did get washed very, very thoroughly. Any more questions? We have a few minutes, 20 minutes, I guess. Yep.
Anybody? Yeah, we almost made it,
10
minutes.
Yeah, Nerf, about Nerf guns.
Uh-huh.
You mod them yourself?
Yep.
Do you increase their range or just make them look weathered?
Whenever you're modding a Nerf gun for a convention, it's always a good idea to disable the trigger. A lot of conventions actually require you to disable the trigger, because they don't want them shooting anything.
No projectiles. So.
Yes.
So they'll actually take them and they'll pull them and make sure none of the mechanisms go off before they'll tag it and let you walk into it.
I modded one a few years back when Zunes were cool. You guys remember Zunes?
Yeah.
Microsoft was trying to make iPods. I had a Zune, which I love that thing, but I modded it so that it would go in the back of a gun that I had, and it had a ammo counter on it. And so I had these pictures that I'd made where if you scroll through them, the ammo counter moves up and down, the number. So all it was just me pressing up and down on pictures, and it looked like the ammo was going up and down. So that's on my personal YouTube page, it's the most liked video that I have, and it's really simple just showing that. But with these, for the most part, we just spray paint them, and then I add rust to them. I wrap the handles in, that's actually leather. If you guys are ever looking for leather, I recommend going to Hobby Lobby, and I think Michael's as well. In their leather section, they have bags of scrap leather. And they are extremely cheap, and you can find some really awesome pieces of leather in there. They have really thick leather, and they also have really thin leather like that. And that's what that is. I just found scrap leather, and I used that to wrap it, because you can cut it to look really nice. So the first time I found that, I was freaking out, because it was amazing. And I keep on buying them, so it's really useful to get those.
You can also, I don't recommend it all the time, but if you see an abandoned couch that's leather, just take a knife to it and cut yourself some scraps out.
I bought a shirt at a thrift store that was leather. It was a leather shirt. And I was like, I'm buying this for two reasons. One, because I need this leather, and two, I'm keeping someone from wearing this hideous shirt. It was gross. It would feel disgusting on your skin.
Especially in Texas.
Yeah, especially in Texas. It's probably why I was at a thrift store. Somebody moved and they were like, oh, I'm not in Minnesota anymore. I'm not going to wear this. It's probably a big thing in Minnesota. Do you have a question?
Actually, I did. For the bolts and stuff.
stuff on that, did you use actual bolts, or did you, like, anything on, like, the sides, your rivets?
Oh, I'm gonna break it off.
There's little bolts and then there's like
really
big.
The rivets are, I actually learned this from Frankie, who is Umaru-chan in the back over there. She actually gave me the idea of doing that, so I learned something from Frankie. They're actually like, when you go to Hobby Lobby and stuff like that, you can buy these little clear plastic sheets that have these little like beads on them. They're like half beads. They're in the scrapbooking section. And so I took those and I just painted the whole thing. I painted all of them gray, and then you stick them on there and they look like rivets. They have adhesive on them already as well. So yeah, you just stick them on there and they just look like rivets. It's just repurposing something. It wasn't made for that.
What about the bigger ones on like the side?
These right here are actually, this one's actually UVA foam that I had to cut to that shape, which was extremely difficult to make it very, look nice. But yeah, that's pretty much UVA foam. But the really small ones are those little beads.
When we originally did it with Steampunk, remember we were using hot glue.
We were
doing hot glue and making it as circular and dropped as possible, and then you just paint over it.
Yes, it was very, very messy. There's hot glue strings coming off of it and stuff. It didn't work very well.
I think with some people will just buy like googly eyes. I mean,
googly eyes work too. Yeah,
anything that's half circle.
And then like Nick was saying, you can use puff paint. Yeah. Puff paint works well, and it works better than.
I got puff paint on my wall because the thing like exploded.
Oh man, I've got my carpet is all kinds of different colors. Puff paint works. But puff paint, put little dots of puff paint and let those, because they smooth out and end up looking pretty good. Nick?
Well, to add on to that, like a couple of different like sheets I did for that, because like things look really cool, like your Fat Man, the little rivets. Rivets, I used either glue, do puff paint, or what I do is I purchase like 100 of them in a bag from Joann's and just stick it on there and then paint over it.
Yeah, they're easily repurposed, but yeah, I mean, they look like rivets. It looks nice. Anybody else? Yes?
How long did the Fat Man take you?
Well, this body of Fat Man took me years of eating whatever I wanted.
30 years.
30 years. My parents not making me exercise. I blame them. I'm just kidding, it's their fault. Yeah. It's my parents. No, it's my fault. It took me about 2 weeks, and that's because when I start working on a prop, I don't stop working on that prop. So I go to work, I come home, I start working on that prop until it's time to go to bed, and then I do the same thing. So yeah, that took me about 2 weeks. And honestly, I freehand the whole thing. I don't measure, which is not, I would not recommend that. I would not recommend not measuring things because it's caused me a lot of problems in the past, but I tend to not measure, I just freehand it all. The good thing about this is it's from a video game, so I was able to get the item in the video game, view it, and have this fully 3D model of it that I could use as a reference, so use video games. Yep.
What's the limit? Like, do you ever find yourself going to
I think that props, I mean, I always like having props. You can overdo it, you can have too many, but I don't know if I completely understood your question. So
my question is, like, would you ever make like an actual suit of like full plate mail armor?
Yeah. No, because it would look really, really awesome, but it would be extremely, it would take a lot of time, it would take a lot of money, and wearing actual metal at conventions, a lot of conventions don't allow that either. They almost didn't allow my wife to bring her frying pan in here, and it was going to be, on her waist the whole time. So yeah, it's a little bit iffy. I would like to, and I definitely want to learn metalworking, but I find that it's easier and cheaper to use, EVA foam, and it's safer.
Angle grinders are scary. They're
terrifying. Hey, look, it's a me. So yeah, I want to say thank you guys for coming out. They gave me the 5-minute wrap it up thing. So thank you guys for checking it out. Be sure to check out our YouTube page and all that stuff if you want any more information on it. And if you see me walking around, you feel free to ask me questions and all that kind of stuff. And my wife has some little flyers back there as you're leaving. So if you want to grab those so you remember Strictly Nerd, Strictly Nerd. Thanks, guys. You guys are awesome.